Okay, good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to be in Homi Center. I've been here many times, but particularly nice to see Professor Arvind Kumar, Professor Pradhan, the previous directors, and of course, the present director has an obligation to be here on this day, and they are the free will. And then my colleagues in chemistry. So one thing nice about place like this is that every year you get a set of bright new faces. And by the time you come back from those of you who get selected, go to the International Chemistry Olympiad and come and receive your medals, or you have received your medals elsewhere and get some recognition, some prize in this country, as much as you don't like, you become history. Because now they, the moment you come back, I've seen Professor Arvind Kumar and company working hard. This year the medalists have come back, they're already started. I had the privilege of working with Dr. Arvind Kumar years ago. I probably should say some of this in the evening, in the later function rather than this technical talk. But let me say this, if I say a few couple of more words later on, doesn't matter. They're already working for the next year. That's the way it goes. Now, in this process, some of us are asked to come and talk to you about certain things in chemistry. That's what I am going to do. And this time, I got my talk vetted by my daughter, who wanted to make sure that it is at the level of class 11 and 12. She knows that you are going for this and you come back and then you will do whatever you want to, science, technology, medicine, whatever. So I hope I make sense. Is this 11 o'clock to 11, right? So in the next 50 minutes, I hope whatever I say makes sense. But the main point I want to drive home here is that every time we teach something, a few years later, things change. Much before Ankush came as a PhD student in, as a master's student in IIT Kanpur, I taught several batches. Some of the things that I used to make statements when I started as a faculty member are no longer true. And what I want to show here is how science keeps on moving, progressing, and the frontiers of science get shifted. It keeps moving. And here, this is not the place to talk about science and technology. This is possible when technological development takes place. Technological development takes place because of scientific development. So they both go hand in hand. So here, what is it that we are trying to say? To look at how to measure reaction rates. You know, the mother or dadima makes curd and says, beta, after 3-4 hours, put it in the fridge. There is some technical problem. But you can see the curd is set. And of course, difficult to measure in real time how the curd is getting set. If you keep opening it and so on, you will disturb it. But at the end of a few hours, you know the curd is set. Inversion of sucrose and anybody who does not know about inversion of sucrose, everybody knows, right? So the sugar, which is called a dextrose, has a positive optical activity. You put some water and acid, it hydrolyzes and gives glucose and fructose, and the optical activity changes to a negative. So this is the sign changes inversion. Historically, it was a very important reaction for which the rates were measured not only at room temperature, but a few degrees above and a few degrees below. And based on that data analysis of that later led to Arrhenius equation. But this is a reaction that you can observe in a few minutes. Actually, your watch is good enough. But there are reactions which take place in a few seconds. So today, we don't need a stopwatch. We used to use a stopwatch, but you can use your smartphone and measure it. But anything less than that is going to be difficult for you to measure with the normal gadgets that you have. You need to go to milliseconds. Already, that was a technological challenge by the 60s. So people had to come up with indirect means. They couldn't come up with a clock that will show milliseconds, but they had to do something that they could observe in milliseconds. And then there were other people who don't wait for things to happen. They are the one leaders of science. They made it possible to measure things in microseconds. Then saying, okay, with the lasers, 10 to the power minus 9, 10 to the power minus 12, 10 to the power minus 15 became possible. We will talk about little bit about these things. Today, the challenging task is to work with attoseconds, right? We are not going to say how we produce attosecond pulse. That's not a chemist's job in some sense. But what can we make use of, how we can use the attosecond and learn something about chemistry, right? And ultimately, if I am a chemist, I need to know what I can do for chemistry. At every stage, there has been technological developments, and you will see as to where these developments are needed. And when you do something outstanding, people do appreciate it. And one of the appreciation that people are happy, I don't want to say look forward to, some people look forward to, and it gets done. So 1967, these three gentlemen got Nobel Prize for being able to measure reaction rate in millisecond in methods called a T-jump, where you suddenly spike the temperature and watch the system relax and make measurements and inferences. This was a case where you have a flash photolysis, you have two plates, and you build charge and let a flash come like a lightning and use that to record events in the microsecond scale. Fast forward about 30 years later, Ahmed Zweil, he made measurements using femtosecond pulse. So when he did this, people used to criticize, well, he didn't develop femtosecond lasers, it was Shank who developed, he didn't develop this technique, what is called a pump and probe, I'll tell you what it means. But he put together those things and he did something more than that. That is what makes today's talk worthwhile. So when you want to look at things, you need if you want to look at space, in space and time, you need things to measure. When I grew up, we used to have a foot scale with inches. And then somewhere along the line, our teacher told us, now you must use the decimal units. We switched over to a meter scale. So I know how to measure in centimeter, and I look for 1/10 of it, millimeter. And then we went to college. We were very happy to see this entity called the micrometer gauge. The screw gauge is what it used to call. We had a lot of difficulties in measuring. We didn't know what we were doing, but we did some experiments, we made some measurements and got some marks and so on. But now I know that we were doing measurements in micron scale. But today, everybody wants to talk about nanometer. Somebody will tell you, your neighbor will come and tell you, beta, wo sab Olympiad, theek hai, aap nano mein kaam karo. Uncle, nano kya hai? Ye humko nahi maalum hai. Nano mein kaam karo, wahi karna hai. So everybody wants to do nanometer scale. We used to call them as colloids, micron or submicron things, and we used to say how to make, we used to talk about Tyndall effect. Nowadays you don't get to see in such air conditioned rooms the Tyndall effect. The classes that we used to study, you will have some sunlight coming in, there was enough dust in the air, teacher would simply say, beta, you look at this, this is what is called the Tyndall effect. But today, you do things in a very careful conditions, measure, and say this is of the order of several nanometers. Then Uncle Raleigh came and said, look, you can make measurement, length measurement. Some of the physicists will forgive me if I make a slip in my statement. If you can measure it up to the wavelength or technically half of the wavelength. So if you're using a light of 400 nanometer scale, you can use up to half of that length accurately you can measure. But anything less than that, you cannot use optical light. You say, look, some of you I know are bright enough. You say, look, don't tell me all this. We know about Bragg's law. We know what Bragg did. He used X-rays, which were sub-nanometer, and they were making measurements. Sodium chloride, the lattice, the distances were measured. using X-rays because they had a wavelength comparable to the inter-ionic spacing in sodium chloride lattice. So we know the difficulty in measuring in sub-nano, well, even in nanometer scale, there are technological developments that makes it possible for people to make measurements. So to look at atoms and molecules, that is where the challenge is for a chemist. You want to look at them in angstrom scale, if not sub-angstrom scale, 0.1 nanometer. So we need a method to measure them, a technique to measure them. That is about the space. So we know already, you can use X-ray diffraction, you can measure it to angstrom scale. You can also use high energy electrons to do electron diffraction, and you can still make measurements of that scale. So space, in principle, that is how we measure. How about time? A train runs at a speed of 100 kilometers per hour. You can convert that into meter per second, 27.7 meter per second. Olympiad medal winner, not you guys. I don't know if any of you can run that fast. But you know, who go to the other Olympiad, Olympic, the medal winner runs at a speed of 10 meter per second. I have rounded it off. It is 9.8, 9.7. The challenge is to break that record every year people try. Now we look at the kinetic energy of molecules. This is, you see, chemists and physicists, olden days, nobody distinguished between chemists and physicists. This made a lot of chemical discoveries, chemists made a lot of physics discoveries, and together they made a lot of discoveries in biology. But without making that distinction, if you want to calculate the average kinetic energy of molecules, so we used to learn the kinetic energy, average kinetic energy is proportional to temperature. We learned how to measure temperature, stick in a thermometer and measure, and my teacher would say, you know, the proportionality constant is R. But I could never understand how they came up with the proportionality constant and PV equal to nRT. And how they come up with R, again, I didn't understand, but we'll not get into it. But what is important is that the average kinetic energy of molecules at room temperature, if you plug in the mass of the value for R, the mass of atoms or molecule, whatever, you can come up with a number like average speed of a hydrogen molecule at room temperature, it's about 1930 meter per second, right? That gives you a feeling how fast atoms and molecules are moving. But what is remarkable is that for a long time, today we are talking about observing reactions in space and time. For a long time, people didn't, they had to assume that, you know, there was Dalton's atomic theory, etc., etc. Chemists and physicists had this imagination that matter is made up of molecules, molecules are made up of atoms. And they all had a lot of indirect evidence. With the indirect evidence that technology and science and technology was developing, now let us come back to the hydrogen molecule. See, if a molecule of hydrogen in this room can, at room temperature, moves about 1,000 meters per second. That's the speed with which it is moving. But left to itself, a hydrogen molecule is going to sit there and vibrate forever. Until you do something with it, it has an equilibrium bond distance. By now, you know about the bond length, right? HH bond length in a hydrogen molecule is 0.74 angstrom. And it has a bond dissociation energy, the energy required to break a bond. Depending upon the unit that you are comfortable, if you are comfortable with kilojoules, 457 kilojoules per mole. And a molecule that is sitting there and vibrating, the spectroscopy is used a unit of centimeter inverse, which converts into that many cycles per second. So in 1 second, the hydrogen molecule is making 10 to the power 12. That means the million into million oscillations in 1 second. But if you turn it around, what is the time taken for one vibrational period? That is 750 femtoseconds. The 0.75 picosecond, that comes to 750 femtoseconds. So if you want to observe a hydrogen molecule which is sitting there and vibrating and want to see it break, you have to do it intervene within this 750 femtoseconds. So you should use something to trigger the breaking within 750 femtoseconds. and you should do something to measure it within 750 femtosecond. And you know the distance is of this order, a bond breaks, so it should take longer than that, and that is the resolution that you need. So I want to set the stage for you. So if you want to observe a molecule breaking, we are talking about sub-angstrom resolution and femtosecond resolution, space and time. So now, how fast do molecules react? Once again, since my two of my children went through high school and so on, I know what is covered, some idea of what is covered in your school book. This is a rate constant. Rate constant gives you a measure of what is called a cross section. There is a speed of the molecule, that is the exponential factor given by Uncle Arrhenius. So if there is no activation energy, they simply come, collide, and react. So you can set this to zero, and let the distance be an angstrom, and the speed be 1,000 meters per second. Actual speed is not so important. We are talking about the ballpark. So the time taken for a reaction is 100 femtoseconds. I'll show you it's going to be even less than that. We are talking about the scale. Then you can use K, the pi, RC square, the collision radius of atom or molecule, the speed, and that's the kind of a speed you get, what is called a rate constant. And you can, if you are used to moles per liter, that's the kind of a unit that you deal with. Now, already I have indicated, without explicitly stating so, what is a chemical reaction. I said there is a hydrogen molecule sitting there and vibrating, and it must break. So bond breaking is a chemical reaction. If two hydrogen atoms come from far off in space and come together and form a hydrogen molecule, you have a bond forming thing. So either you should have a bond breaking or bond forming, or of course you can have a combination of both of them. By the way, it is not so easy. Dr. Arvind Kumar can tell you, two hydrogen atoms, if they come together, they are not going to form a hydrogen molecule. They will come together and go back. Like all of you, you came to the Olympiad, saw each other, first day you didn't talk to each other, and then slowly you were introduced, and then you form your friend circles. So these two hydrogen atoms, if they come and go, if nobody introduces them, like they used to say about the Englishmen, they didn't talk to two Englishmen in a stranded, in an island after a shipwreck, and they were not talking to each other because they have not been introduced to each other. So these two hydrogen atoms must interact. How does interaction take place? Just coming and saying hello to each other is not good enough. Something else must happen. You can have a metal. You can have a third body, which will take away some of the energy from these two hydrogen atoms, and then they form a hydrogen molecule. And then lots of other things take place. If you want to break a bond, similarly, either you must shine a light, or you must hit it with another atom, or a molecule, or a metal surface, or whatever. So most of the time, you really come across a bimolecular process. Very rarely, when people tell you it's a unimolecular process, somewhere they are cheating you. It's preceded by a collision or a light or something. But as it is, the molecule does not break on its own. Yep, bimolecular process is there beforehand. People will tell you, you cannot have a termolecular process. Very difficult to have three atoms collide at the same time. Invariably, there is a bimolecular process taking place beforehand. So most of the time, when people talk about various reactions, that is an underlying bimolecular process. So I said there is a bond breaking or forming, and now the question is, when do you call a reactant and when do you call a product? Somewhere there is a change. So this is where my daughter used to be in the age group that you are in, and you want to be treated as an adult at home, but same time when you want something, you go to your mother and behave like a child. Then she says, Beta, you have been to all the Olympiads and so on, and you are still behaving like a child. You see, look, after all, I am your child. So somewhere you transform from being a child, from a baby to a child to a teenager, teenager to an adult to an old man. Some of us in this room would not like to admit that we are old. Somewhere along the line, we become old men, right? So there is a transition. It is not a sharp line, right? This you must understand. If you have understood this, then my lecture is justified. So somewhere there is a transition. See, what is obvious today was not so obvious in the early part of history of science. So somewhere reactants transform into products. Two hydrogen atoms come together and form a hydrogen molecule. Somewhere they become a hydrogen molecule. A hydrogen molecule breaks into two hydrogen atoms. Somewhere along the line, H2 molecule ceases to be an H2 molecule. It becomes hydrogen. If you bring a hydrogen atom and a deuterium molecule and form a new bond and break the old bond, somewhere along the line, the new bond is formed. Somewhere along the line, the old bond is broken. Now you can go on giving examples, but the point is made. So reinforcing it here. So this is a reactant and that's a product. This is a hydrogen gas, for example, hydrogen gas and chlorine gas. And here it is hydrogen chloride. And somewhere along the line, the transition takes place. Now, how do you identify the transition state? How do you define a transition state? When I look for you, they receive you at the railway station. Father writes, tells uncle or auntie, he comes to the other station, please receive him. He is going to HBCSE or at the airport, wherever. They want to know, I haven't seen your son. Send a photograph. Today, of course, technology makes everything possible. Over my days, it was not so easy. You will say, look, one boy, if he's hesitatingly coming as the last passenger out of the bogie, then he must be my son. Way of characterizing. So structurally, dynamically, you must be characterized. So here is a reactant, and here is a product. And somewhere along the line, it goes through the transition state. I drew this picture. See, this is a happy face. That, you know, is a grumpy face. Everything else is unimportant. One nose, two eyes, etc. The Golwala face or a Lambawala face. The difference between a happy face and unhappy face is this curvature. It's a flat, the guy you cannot tell whether he's happy or unhappy, right? So I just used it as an example. To go from a grumpy face to a happy face, you go through this, whether you like it or not. That's what happens with that. Wigner, actually people, when you go to further, you will learn about Eyring's transition state theory. But about the same time, Wigner, all these physicists will swear about Wigner and his work as a physicist. But he was a chemical engineer and he did his PhD with Michael Polanyi, who was a chemist at that point in time. There's a reason why I say that time he was a chemist, because earlier he was a doctor and later on he was a philosopher. So it's a transition state for him. For a medical doctor to become a philosopher, he went through the transition state called a chemist. And he did a lot of outstanding work which would have gotten him Nobel Prize at some point, but didn't happen. That's a different story. So Wigner did his PhD with Michael Polanyi in chemistry. So he says the transition between the two regions forms the reaction. A dog which is looking at you nicely and suddenly becomes ferocious and bites you. There is a transition. It's a behavioral change. Now you can, each one of you is a nice guy, but put 10 of you together in front of a chemistry lab, you behave differently. Same thing happens outside the compound wall. Two people walking together, talking to each other, and suddenly they pick up a fight. Soon there is a group fighting with each other. So you go from individual behavior to a social behavior. There's a transition. Each one of them can be looked at in the same angle. So the concept of transition state goes beyond chemistry. Incidentally, there was an article by Shushanto on Saha's ionization equation. How many of you have heard about Saha's ionization equation? Right? Meghnad Saha wrote about this several years before these guys wrote about the transition state. But whatever formulas these guys were using from statistical mechanics, Saha was using it 10 years ahead of time. He was looking at the ionization process. An atom, an alkali atom, an electron is removed. So ionization takes place. Somewhere there is a transition. asymptotically there is an alkali, a sodium cation, and there is an electron. Together they form a sodium atom. So how do you calculate the rate for this? So Saha came up with this formula based on equilibrium statistical mechanics, properties of the cation, properties of the electron in the form of what is called a partition function divided by partition function of the neutral ion, and he could come up with the rate equation. Fantastic. And he didn't use the word transition state. The concept of transition state as chemists introduced it was yet to be done. 10 years later that would come. That is why some of these people are considered, you know, great leaders. They have that insight into problems. They come up with the methods. Eyring wrote, even in a flow where there is a viscous plastic flow, that can be described as a chemical reaction. But for our purposes, it is a bond breaking and bond forming in a molecule that constitutes a chemical reaction. So here is the illustration, potential energy versus distance. This portion is how a harmonic oscillator looks like. It simply sits there and vibrates. Everybody knows about harmonic oscillator, right? So the oscillation takes place, but somewhere you must make it anharmonic and break. So this is where the somewhere they become. So where do you decide? Some people operationally use it, 2 times the bond length, right? If 2 people are walking together, they are friends. If they are walking on the other 2 sides of the road, then something has happened. These guys are not talking to each other. They used to be pals in the chemistry Olympiad. Now the distance between the two is decided by the size of the pavement, size of the road, or size of the highway, right? But the fact remains that they have no longer friends. So here it gets a little bit more complicated. A hydrogen molecule sitting there and vibrating, when another hydrogen atom comes in, this starts loosening. This is like, you know, 2 people who are good friends, a third person comes, and once in a while, he is not listening to him, he is looking at him or her, whatever the case. Now slowly the old bond loosens and the new bond begins to form. It's a fundamental question. What is the energy required for this process to take place? One is simple, break the bond and form a new bond. To break a bond, you have to spend a lot of energy, 100 kcal per mole, 400 kilojoules per mole. 1931, Michael Polanyi wrote in a small book called Atomic Reactions. You can Google atomic reactions, Michael Polanyi, you will find. He says, it is not surprising that, what he says is surprising that you spend 10% of the energy, instead of 100 kcal per mole or 400 kilojoules per mole, you spend 10% and the reaction takes place. So the new bond is paying for the old bond breaking. That is the idea. But how does it take place? You have to define a transition state, you have to design a path. The path in which, for hydrogen, for a simple diatomic molecule, it's very easy to define. This is a path in which the bond is breaking. But if you bring a third atom from here or here or here, now you need 3 dimensions. If it is a DNA molecule where the base pair is separating while the rest of the strands are, they are intertwined, right? You focus attention on it. One of the old timers in chemistry said, look, all reactions can be modeled with either a 3-center or a 4-center reaction. Doesn't matter how big the molecule is. A handshake takes place between 2 persons, right? All you require is 2 hands. After the fight, everything is over. Now you become friends, you shake hands. Of course, if you are Modi, you do a hug. It requires a little bit more degrees of freedom, but this is good enough as a symbolic one. So we are talking about going from a reactant valley. See, when we talk, we introduce many terms. I have already in your mind put the concept of a valley and a product valley. If we have talk about valleys, if you have hills and valleys, in a mountainous terrain, in a flat surface, there are no valleys, right? So one is already anticipating some kind of a mountainous terrain where there is a reactant valley which makes the molecule sit there and vibrate, and a product valley where the molecule sits there and vibrate, and somewhere you go through the transition state. And we must do it in the most economically possible way, energetically, economical way. So this is where there is an atom and a molecule, and they come together, and they come on the other side as this. Like you go to the movie, right? A boy and a girl goes, and another girl comes. After the movie is over, this boy is coming out with the other girl. Yeah? Just something like that. Okay? So somewhere along the line, there is a transition taking place. This is the contours. You take a hilly terrain, and you do this what do you call it? The same height. You know, they have the same height. Every point along this line has the same height in a geological contour map. In this case, they have the same energy, less energy here, less energy here, and something happens. So you go from the reactant valley to the product valley, and at every stage, you look for the minimum energy. This is how the molecule BC is oscillating, and this is the minimum point. And as you go, as A comes closer and closer, this BC is now oscillating slightly differently with a less curvature, and at this point, it switches over to the product. So this dashed line is an idealized path. No reaction ever takes place through this path. It took a long time for me when I started as a PhD student. I had a lot of difficulties in understanding this simple plot. But so if you understand, I am happy you understand. If you think you understand, I don't blame you. This is the cross section. If this is reactant, this is product, we go through this line. In a symmetric case like hydrogen, very easy. This side is reactant, that side is product, this is the dividing line. If you look at the energy along this dividing line, along this line it's a maximum, it's a barrier. In a mutually perpendicular direction, it is a minimum. The saddle point, by definition, is a maximum along the reaction path and a minimum along mutually orthogonal position. It was called a saddle. I was telling Ankush before coming here, I decided I will better have a picture of. How many of you have not seen a saddle? Every one of you have seen a saddle, wonderful, whether you sat on it or not. So that is the minimum in this direction, maximum in the opposite direction. While looking for a picture in Wikipedia for a saddle of a horse, I learned something new. This is the mountain called Saddle in Scotland. Because you see, that looks like a saddle. So somebody, some Englishman decided to call it a saddle. Couple of years ago, my wife and I went to Siachen Glacier without knowing we are in Siachen Glacier. Once we reached there and found it was Siachen Glacier, we were excited. Because that's where, you know, a lot of this Kargil war and all those things took place. We had the privilege of having lunch with the army people. While standing there, while on the way, I just went on clicking pictures. Because every little thing here, they reminded me of a saddle. So this is the best picture that I chose from that collection. And you can see, that's a saddle, right? This is a saddle in Siachen Glacier. And if you are here and you want to go to the other side, clearly you can see the road by which you go. That is the road in which the army jeeps went and we also went around. But if you are a common man or you are riding a pony or you are a bakri goat, the goat will not go and look for this. The goat will simply climb over here and unka ghar idhar hai, unka sasral ka ghar jana hai, wo udhar. So it just goes over this minimum path, that is the saddle. Now, what is important is now to translate this into a formalism, calculate rates, make observations, and if your predictions and observations match, then you know that your theory is good and your experiment is worth. This is just the definition of it. In one direction, it is a maximum, another direction, it is a minimum. The energy of this point is what is called the barrier height, that is approximately would correspond to what Arrhenius would call activation energy. I will give you a few examples. That is a simple example. I have been talking about hydrogen atom and hydrogen molecule. It's a neutral. The old bond broken and the new bond formed, they have the same energy. No energy gain, no energy loss. Neutral. This is a case where H2 is broken, HF is formed. It's a highly energetic reaction, exothermic. In the reverse direction, it is endothermic. This is a reaction I spent a lot of time, about 30, 40 years of my life studying this one reaction, but we'll not get into it. The Sun Polani came up with a set of rules. We'll talk about them in a few minutes. This is the original potential energy surface that was devised by London. He gave the formalism. How many of you have heard about London equation? Because at high school, I don't expect you to hear about it. Eyring's equation, have you heard? Eyring's transition state theory, you have heard? I understand you had an exam paper where there was a the transition state was introduced, and the author of the paper. So this is how the original potential energy surface looked like. Don't worry about the details. Okay? What is important is a 3D visualization of it. And this is the old paper of 1930s. Again, what is important here, for you it is not important, when you go to the higher levels, BSc or BTech or whatever, you will see there is a situation where you use a coordinate to consider a three particle motion into a one particle motion. This is the 1973 when I was doing PhD. That is how the potential energy surface got modified, you know, improvement in calculations and our understanding. This is the best surface that is available at this point in time. This is for an exothermic reaction. F atom, a fluorine atom collides with a hydrogen molecule, comes out as a hydrogen fluoride. Somewhere here is a saddle, and you see something very striking. This is the reactant, and the saddle is very, very close to the reactant. The barrier for the reaction is very small. So in this case, this transition state resembles the reactants. Look at the picture in the reverse direction. So now you go from here to here, you have to climb up the barrier and reach the saddle, now close to the product. So in this case, you say the transition state resembles the product. In this case, the transition state resembles the reactants. When every one of you were born, your Dadi Ma would say, oh, the nose looks exactly like his grandfather. His eyes looks exactly like grandmother, you know, etc. That's how people describe. So you describe the transition state resembling the products or resembling the reactants, and this is very typical of exothermic and endothermic reactions. In the case of exothermic reactions, it resembles the reactants. So people use the same method to study four-atom reactions. So when this paper was published in 2000, that is when one of the old-timers said, look, if you can study a four-atom reactions, that means you have learned to study all reactions in principle. Now, what are these Polani rules? This is the father Polani had certain discovered certain things, and the son Polani carried forward the ideas and made measurements which were not possible in father's time, and found out something very simple. If the saddle point is in the entry channel, or if the transition state resembles a reactant, then translation is effective in crossing the barrier. You know, many reactions that you study, for example, go back to the same old curd. You make dahi at home, in winter time, dahi jamta nahi hai. It doesn't become a curd. So your grandmother will say, beta, you put it in a little bit of a hot water, keep it warm for 2-3 hours, it will settle. Summertime, no problem, it forms a curd by itself within a couple of hours. And if you don't take it out, it becomes a sour. So there, heating is effective, but there are reactions where heating is not effective. If I want to go this way out of the room, my momentum should be in this direction. If I keep oscillating in this direction, doesn't matter how much faster and faster I vibrate in this direction, or keep pacing up and down in this direction, it will not help me to go across this door. So if you want to get out of this door, your momentum should be in this direction. If you want to get out of that door, your momentum should be along that direction. What is seemingly so obvious and simple for exiting in a classroom was not so obvious in the case of molecules. So what this gentleman, Polani, did was to show if for an exothermic reaction, it's very counterintuitive. The energy is released by the reaction. If you want to make that reaction go faster, increase the temperature. And what happens then? The product molecule is vibrationally excited. This was a fundamental discovery. If the product molecule is vibrationally excited, and if we can catch it when it is hot and let it cool in a coherent fashion, you will have a laser. So this would be a case. So this formed the basis of forming a chemical laser. He was a starting faculty member in University of Toronto, 25, 26 year old, and he said, look, if you observe the exothermic reaction and catch it, technology was needed to make this observation of a infrared photon being emitted by this freshly formed product. He said you should get infrared chemiluminescence. And years later, he put together a lot of data, he and his students, and came up with this picture. In this reaction, energy is released, hydrogen chloride is formed, this is much stronger than this bond. When a lot of energy is released, it is released in exothermic reaction. It is predominant, a lot of it is present in vibrationally excited state. When compared to the ground state, that is the ground state zero energy, a lot of energy goes into vibration. In comparison, very little energy goes into rotation. This is a it's a triangular plot. This is zero energy in vibration. This is all the energy is in vibration, all the energy is in rotation, all the energy is in translation. If all the energy is released completely in translation, the points will be on this line. If all the energy was in vibration, they will all be there. If all the energy was in rotation, they will be there. So what they found out was, there was a substantial amount of energy in vibration. Then he wrote a small paper and said, if first of all, this is called a chemiluminescence, chemical reaction emitting a light. The jugnu, the firefly that you see, is a bioluminescence. It's a chemical reaction taking place in a biological system, light coming out in visible region. In this case, chemical reaction emitting light in infrared region. This chemical laser, this chemiluminescence, if done in a coherent fashion, will result in chemical lasers. So he and his head of the department went to the university lawyer and said, we must patent it. You know, today you hear so much about innovation, entrepreneurship, patenting, etc., etc. People will tell you, there's not enough to do science. You must do science which is useful to society. You must convert. Now, if you go to ISER Mohali website, it will say, in pursuit of knowledge. So I told somebody, you know, our goal is in pursuit of knowledge. He said, beta, you must convert knowledge into wealth. That's what everybody does. You also must convert knowledge into wealth. So this young man and his head of the department went to the lawyer and said, we must patent it. I told him, why do you want to waste your energy in patenting it? So they came back. They didn't patent. But somebody else said, look, if that is the way to form a chemical laser, I will form the chemical laser. So when that is in one direction it went. So chemical lasers, when you hear about Star Wars, right? About 20 years ago, it was very fashionable to talk about Star Wars. A lot of basis of those Star Wars speculation was based on chemical lasers. You just simply add up more and more of it, and then you can destroy almost anything that you want. But when Polanyi was describing this discovery to another scientist, he said, you know, if energy is released in the form of vibration, now you work backwards. The principle of microscopic reversibility. My daughter used to sit and watch TV almost every day and watch this Mr. India movie. You know, Sridevi is no more. Hey, have you seen Mr. India movie? Anybody in this room who has not seen Mr. India? Right? You have not seen. Right? So you see it sometime. It's a fun movie. There, Anil Kapoor tells Sridevi, she is looking for an apartment. Hmm. this staircase takes you upstairs and the same staircase will bring you down. That is the common man's way of stating principle of microscopic reversibility. If energy is released in the form of product, vibration, in the reverse direction, vibration should be helpful in forming the products. So that is what they inferred indirectly. Make a molecule vibrationally excited, the reaction will go faster, not necessarily by simply heating with a Bunsen burner or with an electrical heater. And then they showed experiments, we will not go into the details of this. Oh, this is an important one. On the other hand, you decide to make the reactant molecule rotate faster and faster. Like in this case, go back to this example. If I want to get out of this room, my momentum should be in this direction, not as a vibration in this direction, and doesn't help you. I can keep on doing this rotation faster and faster, right? I don't get out of this room. I stay inside the room. I simply rotate faster. It doesn't help my reaction. In some times, it may even be unhelpful. Rotation can inhibit the reaction. Now, by looking at all these things, Michael Polanyi got his Nobel Prize in 1986 along with Hirschbach and Lee. But all this concept of a transition state, predicting, observing what happens in an exothermic reaction, what happens in endothermic reaction, they're all indirect evidence. You enter the room and you go out with a bloody nose, then somebody says, ah, somebody punched you in the nose. Just not seen somebody punching in your nose. For all you know, you could have fallen down, hurt yourself. For all you know, you might have tried to hit a mosquito and then you hit. Many things can happen. But he infers as to what must have happened inside this room. So these are all amounting to indirect evidence. But people were not happy. I knew John Polanyi was excited about it, wanting to observe the transition state. Ahmed Zuhail was not in this business explicitly. And he also joined this. They wrote a paper called Holy Grails in Chemistry. What is something special you must do in chemistry? They said, we must observe the transition state. This was in the 80s. Father Polanyi had done a lot of alkali flame experiments. This is Michael Polanyi, alkali flame. You Google, you will get all the details. So the son Polanyi said, look, if I look at this reaction, this is a sodium atom. The normal yellow light that you see in a sodium lamp, in a physics lab, we used to measure the wavelength of a sodium lamp, sodium light. If you observe when sodium is just being freshly formed, you will find a slight shift in the yellow light. You know, these people who have interest in astronomy, astrophysics, they make their living out of measuring the shift. Right, Hubble's law, the red shift in the emitted light, expanding universe, all that stuff they talk about, all that depends on this shift in the wavelength. So these people said, look, you must observe the shift in the wavelength. It will be a million times weaker signal, but if you look for a signal which is million times weaker, you will find the wings. And they found the wings. But Zuhail took a slightly different route. This is where, when a freshly formed sodium ion emits light, sodium D-line emission, but when it is being formed, in the process, the emitted light can have a different wavelength. And by looking at the shift in the wavelength, you can find out the forces that is the difference. A little complicated way of doing things. And they found experimental evidence for it. One, a million times weaker signal when compared to the sodium D-line. Ahmed Zuhail said, look, I want a record. Let me just see. Go ahead and see. Put a CCTV camera inside. CCTV, no? You put a camera inside the room, in the auditorium, we will know who punched whose nose. Right? Direct evidence. Make the observation. So he decided to do this. And that's how the femtosecond chemistry came. Many of us who are studying these problems theoretically using computers had studied the change in the bond distance. When an atom and a molecule come together, this atom is coming in closer to this and this atom is leaving. So you just measure this distance and you can tell whether the reaction is taking place or not. This is decreasing and this is increasing. Somewhere here is the transition state of the order of a few femtoseconds. But if they are ionic species, they hang around together to go or not to go, to go today, to not to go to tomorrow. They keep on doing this. They spend a lot of time, order of picoseconds, 1,000 times more time. Sathyamurthy Dwell said, look, let me look at a reaction hit with a photon and watch the molecule falling apart. This was ICN molecule. He broke, the CN remains intact, the cyanide group remains intact. The IC part breaks, and he was able to observe this in femtosecond time scale, and then he recorded evidence. And what he did was to pump, you put energy and pump it into this tape, and then as it is falling apart, you probe this. Use another laser to measure this energy. It's called a pump and probe experiment, and you do this in real time. So in terms of a real time, 200 femtoseconds, he was able to make the measurements. That was a fantastic one, you know, really out progressive experiment. But then he did one more experiment where they were looking at sodium iodide. A sodium iodide, diatomic molecule, you know, sodium is Na plus I minus, sodium chloride, sodium Na plus Cl minus. The old experiment, X-ray diffraction of common salt, we know there are ionic species there. But when you have a gaseous sodium iodide, sometimes it behaves like a new covalent molecule, sometimes it behaves like an ionic species. So you can look at the transition between the two kinds of behaviors, and you can pump light and make sodium iodide into the excited state. When it is in the excited state, it leaks. A part of it leaks and forms a covalent species. The remaining portion will go back. So this goes back and forth oscillation. This back and forth oscillation will go on decreasing, because every time there is a small amount leaking, I'll say about 10% leaking. So 90%, 90% of the 90% remaining is 81%, 90% of 81% is 72%. So this signal goes on decreasing in height, but the distance between the peaks in time, the time difference between the two, tells you the vibrational period. So he was able to demonstrate experimentally the vibrational period of sodium iodide. He also did it for iodine molecule, not only vibration but also rotation. So he was able to do this experiment. This is the principle of pump and probe. You bring a laser beam, you put a beam splitter. Part of it goes and pumps the sample, and a part of it goes through, and it comes goes through various materials, and it undergoes what is called a harmonics generation. The wavelength gets shorter and shorter and shorter by multiples, 2 times, 3 times, double harmonics, triple harmonics, 100 times harmonics, whatever. So if it is a visible light, becomes ultraviolet, ultraviolet even, then it goes into X-rays. So the wavelength that is coming out here to probe can be several times smaller than the original laser. Now, what is challenging was the distance traveled by this laser and this laser is of the order of a micron if you want to measure in femtoseconds. Normal spectrometers depend upon several centimeters. But here, the difference between the two path length is a micron, approximately. And if you have to put it through another nonlinear sample here, and for it to come out, time-wise, there is not much of a problem. It is a distance. This is the extra distance that you have to travel. What was important was, he said, look, if this light that comes out here can knock an electron out, don't let the electron go, let the electron take a picture of the molecule. It's like a Modi taking a selfie, right? So you let an electron go, and the electron undergoes a diffraction with the molecule and gives you an image. Now, first it gets tricky to do this experiment, to make the observation, and one molecule, one electron is not enough to record the E1. You must have several of them. So it may not be, it may be electron coming out of one Modi, but taking a selfie of another Modi, because they all look clones, right? The reason I put Modi as an example is today this is common. You see several pictures of Modi face everywhere, right? And everybody take, how many of you have, who has not taken a selfie so far in this room? Let us leave my generation out here, right? Every one of you have taken a selfie of yourself and your friend, right? This is what the molecule does. Now, to make a molecule do and get a picture is a challenge. And that's what Ahmed Zoel was able to do. And he recently died of cancer. Before that, he was trying to see if he could do this and take a picture of a DNA double helix unzipping in real time and space. Right? It's like you change your banyan for whatever advertisement you are doing. Shah Rukh Khan, somebody or Salman Khan, removing the banyan for a picture, right? I don't know how much money he makes by removing the banyan. But you take a picture of it, and that guy probably makes a living by eating roti sabji on the platform. Doesn't matter. So what is important is what has been possible. Femtosecond ho gaya. I said, people like me said, look, femtosecond is where chemistry takes place. Bond breaks, bond form. The physicists would not stop with femtosecond. They want to develop attosecond. And they developed. Technique has to change. Methodology changes. So we said, oh, attosecond can be used to knock electrons from the core. So you can do ionization, core ionization spectroscopy. You can knock electron out of the core of an argon atom and do the measurements. Physicists were very happy. People like me said, look, there's no fun. But we didn't realize when you knock electron out using this attosecond pulse, uncertainty principle tells you delta E delta T is greater or equal to H bar. If this is 10 to the power minus 18 seconds, I'll leave it as a homework for you to find out delta E. That energy spread is enough to break a molecule. It's enough to take an atom or a molecule from the ground state to several excited states. Which means you have a chemical reaction now taking place not from the ground state, but from a variety of excited states. Right, each one of us behave differently when under different conditions. All these behaviors go into one and something comes out. Then we have to figure out, later on we will figure out as to which one of them came, when it was Shant Surupi, when he was in angry mood, when he was in a crazy mood, you know. Many things we do, but as a matter of analysis. But what is important is to realize, now we are talking about a different chemistry, it is atochemistry. We don't know the details. Some of you, when you go to higher studies, maybe one of you will do attosecond physics, maybe one of you will do attosecond chemistry, and whatever results you get, send me an email, nsathyamurthy@gmail.com, that I listened to you on that day, I have done this attosecond physics, chemistry, or biology, and this is what I have found, and this is going to change history of science. The beauty of science is that you ask one question, and you answer, and this answer raises another question. And you keep asking these questions. And science grows. We become old, we go out. You people, young people, become scientists, discoverers, and you get old. And you then train the next generation. How many of you have not seen the journal called Resonance? You have not seen. All the medalists, they get a subscription, right? I'll find out. Earlier, the tradition used to be, as KVPA scholars get, and earlier the medalists used to get a copy of one subscription of 1 year free from the academy. I will request Ankush and the coordinator to send me a list of the medalists, and we'll arrange to send you free copies. But this is a journal meant for undergraduates. Meant for people like you. This is the January issue of it, which gives a picture of Michael Polanyi and the potential energy surface. It tells about Michael Polanyi, how as a doctor he was writing papers in chemistry, and as a chemist, how he was writing papers in philosophy. This is the next issue. It has not come out yet. Yesterday, I saw the cover page of this magazine, the journal, about about eight, nine years ago, Zweil and Thomas wrote a book, 4D microscopy. I was curious. I bought a copy. I paid $15, got an e-version of the book, and started reading it. I didn't quite realize the importance of this. But when I was preparing for this talk and I was editing this issue, I realized the significance of observing chemical reactions in space and time by doing 4D microscopy. So his contribution is described in the next issue. So it's available free. So you are all Google generation, right? You Google resonance, you go to January issue, you will get articles about Michael Polanyi. Wait for 10 days, today is 2, by 12th of June, it will be out, June issue will be out. You Google resonance, June issue, you will find whatever little, certain things that I have talked about there. Okay? And I want to, we got short by extra another 5 minutes or so. I want to thank Ankush for asking me to come and share with you excitement of whatever I described. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sathyamurthy. We can take a few questions for next 5 to 10 minutes. Any questions for Professor Sathyamurthy?
So in the diagram, when we were performing 4D microscopy, we were using one laser source and we were separating it using a beam splitter. So, and when we use this harmonic amplifier or whatever that is called, so why is it necessary to use one source? And if we use, say, one source for directly sending light into probe and one for, low wavelength light, we don't have to worry about the path length thing. So why is it necessary to have one source?
Yeah, I punch in your nose and take a picture of him. You understand the difference? When I punch in your nose, I should take a picture of my punching your nose in real time and space, right? If you don't do a beam splitting and use some other light, unfortunately this picture seems to indicate what you are indicating. See, here is a little light. You are not able to see it, so not bright enough. Here is a little photon. It's a wavy thing here. A photon which excites the molecule, which is breaking apart. It is another part of this photon which generates an electron and takes a picture. That is why it is a selfie. You punch, right? Sometimes you see in the movies, no? That the fellow punches his nose himself and then goes out and complains that he punched my nose, right? So but you are not interested in proving somebody else, you want to show how you punch your nose. What is it? Blue whale, right? How many of you have heard of blue whale? Yeah. I would have been happy in this case if we did not know about it. So some people follow the blue whale, and some crazy guy tells that you must commit suicide and you have to have a CCTV camera on to record your own committing suicide. Right? It's some stupid guy. He is not killing himself, but he is asking you to kill yourself and tell the world that how you are killing yourself, right? So this is a case where you want to excite the molecule and you want to take a picture of it breaking its bond or forming a bond. So it is there, that is why the beam splitter is necessary. Otherwise they are independent, that's not a big deal.
So in the pump and probe setup, you mentioned that the probe wavelength is shorter, right? So that will have a higher energy. Why doesn't that cause the reaction instead of the pump pulse?
Yeah, it's very, very, very good question, very important question. When George Porter did the flash photolysis, it was a pump and probe using the same light. But later on people found, like in this case, the purpose was not, if we just simply did the pump probe experiment, see, I mentioned that some people were critical of saying what was so special about Ahmed Zweil doing experiment. Kinsey in MIT was one of the pioneers in pump and probe. So here you see there is a pump and there is a probe. they were using two lasers to do the pump and probe. But you want to record certain event, then you have to change the wavelength. That is when it becomes a spectroscopy. In this case, the purpose was not just to do a spectroscopy of the transition state, which was the original experiment that people were talking about when they were talking about the Holy Grail. But what Zoel did was to go one step further. And let me take a picture, that too of a selfie, of a molecule like that. The physicists will tell you how they could talk about a single photon interference. If there could be a single photon interference, there could be a single electron interference, definitely single X-ray photon interference. But these are nuances. If you ask me further questions, I will say you please ask these people. But what is important is that we have a clones. It is a, let us say, ozone molecule falling apart, not just one of this one, several ozone molecules. When people talk about a single molecule spectroscopy, they don't really mean single molecule. They are making observation of a set of molecules, and there is a certain behavior which can be attributed to a single molecule. So to take this into space and time, the probe has to be of a different wavelength. Yes, sir.
Sir, if we are observing the molecule in any container, then obviously there will be many species, means millions of reaction pairs going on at the same time. So how will you focus on a particular reaction thing? It is possible that the focus changes.
Yeah, see, when you see Shah Rukh Khan jumping over the cliff, he actually doesn't jump. It is a stuntman who does it. And he may or may not actually do the jumping. You produce different frames, and then you do the editing. So this is what happens. So when we say observe a molecule, remember they cannot be distinguished. You cannot tell one ozone molecule from another ozone molecule. By definition, they are indistinguishable particles. You have a collection of non-interacting molecules. It's important that they are non-interacting. Otherwise, they will start interfering with themselves. So when we say single molecule, we actually mean getting the property of a single molecule from a collection of non-interacting molecules. It's not cheating, but a little bit of a cheating in the language or in the description.
If you have no further questions, I thank Professor Sathyamurthy for this lecture, and we have a short tea break, and then we gather back around 11:35 for the valedictory function. Thank you.
Thank you.